Here goes nothing. Oh, this is so nerve-wracking. Hello, people on the internet. I have a casting couch in my shop now. Ta-da! This is nice though, isn't it? I have a little seating area. A little place to put your drinks and your snacks.
If you guys aren't caught up and you want to get caught up because that's a smart thing to do, this is Mr. Dose, and up above in the top corner of the screen is the last video where I worked on it. Let's get this thing to start.
That's an A&N fitting. That's a black fuel line. I bought all new fuel lines. I gotta build a bunch of this stuff so I can try to get this thing to start. Here goes nothing. Hope I don't screw this up. Okay. I don't know how to play the flute.
Just put a little bit of lube on this thing. Makes me nervous doing these though because they're so expensive. I don't want to screw one of these fuel lines up.
What happened in the year 1916? Because that's what size wrenches these are. You're welcome for that useless information. Ooh. See? Fuel line. First one. I'm gonna make three or four of them. And it's gonna go from my flex fuel sensor. I'll go underneath to the fuel pressure regulator. Please disregard all the spaghetti everywhere. That will get tucked away in a minute. I know there will be at least one person that will comment about all the wires everywhere. I have to loom them still once the car is fully operational.
That right there is the end of the fuel rail. So what I'm gonna have to do is run a 180 degree fitting right here to send my return back through the center of the intake manifold.
Go in your hole. Okay, I think that's in there. I gotta put lube on it. Oh, I hate this part. I hate this part very much. I need some wrenches. It stinks. It smells like robot sperm.
There you go. It's a shitty flavored candy cane.
I must route the line. How am I gonna do this? I don't wanna scratch it.
This is so hard for me to do because I have such bad OCD and I want this to look perfect. It's gonna follow the rail right here. And I think that's a hard line right there for coolant. It'd be kind of nice, like above it maybe. And then it'll go under the intake and above the starter. The return pipe that has to connect to is attached to the firewall. And if I wanna do it super clean, I would just cut it down below and attach it down there, but the only way to do that would be for me to drop the fuel tank. So this guy right here, it's a little 180, that's all the fishery that has to attach to it to get to that hard line. Basically that would sit like there, and then the line will attach on the bottom. Done, time to cut it. Done. Now this, we'll go to my fuel filter.
Time travel, an hour into the future. That's flared. Is it fitting on there? This is a pain, and I can't wait to get out of this engine bay.
One last line. This is gonna go on the fuel filter. That's funny, Red Horse, that's a squadron. Not sponsored, FYI. Why does this one look weird? This is the last one, I promise.
I have a bench vise. Do I use it? No. What do? I struggle like an idiot.
Even though I blew these lines out with compressed air, I think the smart thing would be is to prime the system and leave it disconnected before it goes into the fuel rail. That way it can wash out all these lines going up to the fuel rail. And I know the fuel rail itself is clean.
I forgot to buy copper crush washers for the banjo fitting. So something like that, bunch of black spaghetti. I don't like that coolant hose, that's gonna go. I'm gonna redo that. But yeah, the intake pretty much hides it all. And then you can see, it'll run right along the cable for the speedometer. And I'm gonna get something that like kind of holds these two together. But yeah, tucks right back there behind the intake. I'm gonna redo this plug also. This is gonna be hidden behind here, so you won't even see that. And also this hose is gonna be gone too. I'm gonna route that under the intake.
I'm just letting you know this stuff in case you never watch another one of my videos again, you don't think I'm that messy.
I'd be really sad if you didn't watch another one of my videos again. I work really hard. It rained. It finally rained here. Finally. It's later in the day. I'm getting to a late start because I had to edit the Gump review that you may or may not have just watched. Not my Gump. It's a cousin Gump to this Gump. Going down. Hose. There's a bunch of vacuum plugs. Oh, right in front of me. Hose. It's a big hose. So she said. Probably do something. I hate vacuum hose. It's ugly. Oh, come on. This thing looks like the talons of an owl. Owl talons.
If I trim that one up, they'll kind of flow together. It's not terrible. I'm not a fan, but it's not terrible.
Let's see if I can do this without losing an eye. No eyeballs lost. Whew. That scares me. Of course I would save the most difficult one for last because I'm fucking intelligent. Ouch! Oh, this is terrible. This is absolutely abysmal. I don't want to take this all back off to get that bottom one. Okay. I'm gonna have so many bruises on this arm. It is not even funny.
Can she get it in the first time? That's what he said.
Oh, geez.
I did it, I got it in. So he said, again, innuendos don't stop. They just keep coming. That's what she said.
The great thing is, all this gets to come off again when I go to loom everything. Yay! I still had one more problem that I had to figure out how to solve, and that was how I was going to attach the throttle cable to the intake manifold with this new throttle inlet. The factory one had a little bracket attached to it that would hold your throttle cable in place, but this new inlet doesn't have it. So I used my brain power and engineered a piece of cardboard with dots on it. And people with bigger brain power that make barbecue grills for a living next door made a permanent bracket.
First coat, second coat.
Hi, welcome to the next day. I just saw a little ground squirrel running down the sidewalk and I think I found where it lives.
Right over here.
There's this little drainage culvert thingy in the sidewalk. I just put a piece of cinnamon roll right there and a little cup of ice water. So I don't know if there's any babies in there, but at least the little squirrel will have some fresh water and a snack.
I can't capture this thing on camera. Every time I go out there, I spook it before I can even get the camera to focus on it.
I get this throttle bracket assembled, set these air gaps, try to start the car.
Get it to the chopper.
Oh. Hey, look, there's a wrench. I was wondering where that 10 millimeter wrench went.
So this Hall effect sensor right here should be easy to set the air gap on because you can see it. The other one is a little bit trickier. I'm gonna add a plug down here when I loom everything just so it makes this a little bit easier. In the future, because it's hard to spin these when there's tension from the wires. So that's touching the tooth.
I did a thing. I didn't film it because it was gonna be real quick, but now I realize you're gonna notice that something's missing under the car because I sent it to powder coating.
I don't know if you noticed that something under here is not under here that was under here a second ago that was white.
I took them off and I'm getting them powder coated so they match the car.
The last step, I gotta pull off the number one plug so I can set this thing at top dead center. Can I pull this out? Yeah, look at that. I can pull it out without having to do that. Oof. Well, this thing was running pretty good because that plug looks brand new still. So, put this into the crank. I'm gonna turn this thing until just visually it looks like it's at top dead center, and then I'll lock this thing into place at what I think is TDC, and then watch my gauge to see as it starts to go up or down so I really know where exact top dead center is. I need two people.
Keep going. That.
All right, so that is set at zero. I go back. Okay, right there. So right there is where it starts to go back down. Ooh, this is tricky. That's it. That's top dead center right there. Now I need to mark the tooth that is lined up with the Hall effect sensor for TDC. So that way I know for future reference.
Rather than just count the rotations on the threads, I'm actually gonna measure. This is 0.062 of an inch,
which is 1.57 millimeters, 1.21 gigawatts. Two rotations would be one rotation. That's roughly two rotations. Let's see if that is exactly what the measure should be. Oh, wow, that is dead on, okay. Perfect, good to go. This right here is the Hall effect sensor on the cam trigger. So I gotta do the exact same steps I just did down below. And drop my bolts because I'm fucking wonderful. So the way this works is there's a shaft in here, it attaches to the camshaft in the same fashion that the original distributor would. And then that has a lobe on it that rotates with the camshaft in this Hall effect sensor. It's basically a magnetic pickup. Every time it passes by this little sensor, it counts for the computer. So that is touching right there. Now I need to back this off two rotations. So I'm gonna make a mark right here. That's one rotation. That's two rotations right there. Now that I have the air gap set on the cam trigger, I'm going back down to the crank because I gotta rotate the engine over two full rotations and then set cylinder number one at top dead center before I can do the crank trigger.
All the data that I can bring up on setting these cam and crank triggers is extremely vague at best. And I'm trying to figure out how this ECU is even gonna know what top dead center is for timing.
This is actually super confusing to figure out. I've been racking my brain for like the past hour trying to figure this out because the air gaps are simple, but how the ECU is actually supposed to know what top dead center is for timing, I think it would have to rely on the lobe that is on this little shaft for the cam trigger and also the gap in the wheel on the crank. That's what would make sense to me. I got a hold of someone who is smarter than I am. What I'm stressed out about is stuff you have to configure in the computer when you're setting it up. You have to set all this stuff up in the software.
Battery is connected.
Here goes nothing. Oh, this is so nerve-wracking.
Let's see what happens when I turn this into the run position, fire up the ECU. All right, battery light is on. That's reading. In theory, my ECU should have power right now. Ooh, the light's on the ECU. That means I did something correct.
I don't understand the computer part. I suck at computers.
If I recall correctly, these ECUs are locked. So,
no support agents are currently available to take your call. Please leave your name and either an email or phone number, and we will get back to you as soon as possible. Thank you.
I found the problem. I have tried every USB outlet on this laptop that I borrowed.
It's not even recognizing it whatsoever, and everything is fine with the ECU.
It's just this laptop.
I'm going to just take the ECU out of the car. And those guys have a desktop next door. It works fine on the desktop next door. You plug in the USB and it sees it right away. It says link ECU in the bottom right corner. So I literally just went to Walmart and bought the cheapest laptop they had so I can try to get this to work. Getting this thing cracked, unlocked, ready to go. And that right there, peoples, is the access to my ECU. It's ready to tune. It is late as hell, but I am now into my ECU. The ignition is on right now. No smoke is being let out, and I can see some of the sensors are showing up on that ECU as reading them. So the next video you guys see hopefully will be tuning and starting this car. I'm ending it here because it is fucking late. So I'll see you guys soon with another video. Bye.